Have you ever been to Bahia? Well, if you haven't, my friend here can tell you all about it.
Bahia.
Jose Carioca is a slick, debonair malandro from Rio de Janeiro. His expertise in Brazilian culture and his love for the samba dazzled audiences, especially those in Brazil. Many animators worked on him, including Bill Tytla, Ollie Johnston, and Fred Moore. But his most famous sequence, The Three Caballeros, was animated by a man we've already covered twice before. So, without further ado, welcome to the final installment of our Ward Kimball series. Before we start, don't forget to check out our Patreon, our Discord, and of course, like and subscribe. In the last two installments, we talked a lot about Ward's life. He was born on March 4th, 1914 in Minneapolis and went to school at Santa Barbara School of the Arts in order to become a painter and illustrator. Instead, he got a job at Disney for the money and stayed for the innovative work the company was doing. Ward was well known for his practical jokes.
There was one gag that I went down the Salvation Army and I collected a lot of old shoes. You could buy them then for 50 cents a pair. And I bought secondhand trousers. And I got the studio very early one morning after I'd been bringing the shoes in one pair at a time and stashing them in my room. I went into all the men's cans. I had made these little U-shaped wooden braces, and I put it in the shoes and let the pants sort of wrinkle down below. So if you looked underneath, it looked like the stall was occupied. And I would climb up over the top of the door and leave it there. Well, sometime around 10 o'clock, the accumulation of the male population in the studio on having to use the Johns had sort of reached a explosion point, because they'd go in and beat on, hey, hurry up in there, what's going on? And they'd look down underneath to make sure, and they'd see the shoes in the ring. And that went on till about 2 in the afternoon.
Ward worked on a deleted soup scene for Snow White and subsequently moved on to Jiminy Cricket in Pinocchio. You can learn more about that right here. Oops, I mean, here. For Fantasia, Ward, along with Walt Kelly, was given Bacchus and Jocus, the drunken god and his donkey, in the Pastoral Symphony segment. Ward also helped with the many centaurs in the film.
We'd never done centaurs before. Half human, half horse. The guys were big, robust, macho centaurs, but the girls, what do you do when you have a young girl the front end and a horse on the rear? How do you handle the anatomy, and what do you show and what don't you show? I have a whole stack of memos about how things should be drawn and long shots and close-ups and so forth. That's pretty humorous in itself.
Ward states in an interview with Jim Corcus, "My favorite scene in Fantasia is the Dance of the Hours, with the hippo and the alligator. I wish I had worked on that. Instead, I got stuck on the Pastoral Symphony, with Bacchus chasing the centaurettes. I hated those candy box colors in that scene. Oh, I just remembered. I also like The Night on Bald Mountain. Artistically, it was probably our greatest effort. And at the same time it came out, it was a bomb. Walt felt pretty bad about it. He thought he was going to bring a little culture to the American people and the world. It did get rediscovered later. Kids ask me if we were on some drugs when we made that picture. And I say no, we were just trained that way. We thought that way. The strongest drug we had was an occasional martini." Disney's next film was a unique one. The Reluctant Dragon was essentially a tour of the then-new Walt Disney Studios facility in Burbank, California. The film stars radio comedian Robert Benchley and many Disney staffers, such as Fred Moore, Norman Ferguson, Clarence Nash, Walt Disney, and Ward Kimball, all as themselves.
Pretty soft for you just making funny pictures all day.
You think so? Well, the first 100,000 are the hardest.
I know who it is now. Goofy. Only three fingers?
Yeah, saves time and looks better.
Don't forget that other button. No shoes? Boy, what size are those?
Oh, about 15 and a half.
There you are.
Now let's see how the whole scene looks. Ready?
Okay, shoot.
Ward also animated the very title character himself, the Reluctant Dragon.
I do not wish to discuss it further. I refuse to listen. I absolutely will not fight. Good night.
Do you remember where they sent the reluctant dragon back, the whole thing, to be ripped to ink and paint?
I'll only be a minute.
Because the Hayes office wouldn't let him put a belly button in the dragon. Do you remember that?
Oh, yes.
Oh, dear.
Did you guys know that?
No.
Oh, you love this.
The reluctant dragon was almost ready for release, and the Hayes office looked at it and said, you can't show the navel. They had to send the entire picture
back. On a
back.
Dragon, for sakes.
Oh, I'm mad, I'm mad.
After work on Dumbo, for which he animated the crows, Ward animated some of Pedro in Saludos Amigos, which turned out to be one of the weakest assignments of his career. However, the second film in the Latin American series, The Three Caballeros, turned out to be an absolute highlight in Ward's career. Woohoo! He animated the extremely entertaining and brilliantly choreographed scene, which I have not watched every day for a month, The Three Caballeros song sequence. No, really, I'd rewind and rewatch this film so often, I broke our VHS.
We're three caballeros, three gay caballeros. They say we are birds of a feather.
I was given this long song that went on for three and a half, 4 minutes, and no business. So I listened to the song for about a week. I turned all the lights out in the room. And just listen to the song, and I visualized it. And I said, there's nothing I can do except being literal about it. When they say we're three happy chappies with snappy serapis, all of a sudden the serapis appear.
We're three happy chappies with snappy serapis. You'll find us beneath our sombreros. We're brave and we'll stay so. We're bright as a peso. We say so, the three caballeros.
One of the first criticisms when the director saw the pencil test is, well, the duck goes out to the right and he comes in on the left. And the rooster goes out at the top and he comes in from the bottom. You can't do that. It's not logical. You have to have these tie-ups. You have to make sense. And I said, look, who cares? Guy runs on the left, comes in on the right. I mean, that gives it its flavor, its craziness.
The whole thing is not only perfectly timed out, but it also features great actions and gestures to support the lyrics clearly. It's one of my favorite sequences, Ward says. The song was put in at the last minute because Walt felt there needed to be a song. I was given no direction, so I came up with the staging myself, making them do literally whatever they were singing. I went to one of the sound guys and had him extend the last note by 15 to 20 seconds, so I could do the bit where they try to dampen that last note. It gave the whole thing a real touch. Ward continued to shine in the years of World War II. First came Make Mine Music, where Kimball animated most of all the characters in the satirical but tragic The Whale Who Wanted to Sing at the Met. A whale who can sing? Pfft, I don't believe it. As well as the cat. Duck. And huntsman. In the Peter and the Wolf segment. The shot of the huntsman walking is a textbook example of balance, pacing, and weight in action.
Wait a minute, I'll show you. W-O-L-F. Wolf. Wolf! To the rescue!
Then came Fun and Fancy Free, where the animator reprised his role of Jiminy Cricket, as well as animating Bongo and Lumpjaw, the villainous black bear in the Bongo segment. Probably his best animation from this period, however, is in the third of the four package features, Melody Time. In it, Ward was the primary animator on the legendary cowboy, the toughest critter west of the Alamo, Pecos Bill. The cartoony style of the short and its broad but precise and witty sensibilities are in perfect balance. This is also one of the few times that Kimball had a successful collaboration with his rival, Milt Kahl. The two had very different opinions on animation, and their personalities clashed to the point where they were studio nemeses of sorts. Milt even bashed him frequently in interviews and said that his work, as well as that of Frank, Ollie, and Mark, was far superior to Ward's. However, in this segment, the two styles go together seamlessly, and there's a lot of great animation.
Once there was a drought that spread all over Texas. So to sunny California, he did go. And though the gag is kinda corny, he brought rain from California. That's the way we got the Gulf of Mexico. So yippee-yay-yay, yippee-yay-o, for the toughest critter west of the Alamo.
They were both raised to a height that they never could have done alone, explained Ken Peterson. Milt broadened out his caricature and held Kimball down a little bit. Last came Ichabod Crane and Mr. Toad, where Kimball did Toad's escape and some of Ichabod and his horse in the nighttime ride sequence. From here, Ward began to lose his battle for the Disney style. You can hear all about it here, but essentially, Disney animation was becoming softer and rounder, instead of cartoony and abstractist. Sort of a Disney puberty, if you will. Ward eventually found new life in directing shorts like Toot, Whistle, Pluck, and Boom, and the Man in Space series. In 1955, Walt Disney announced that he would produce Babes in Toyland as an animated feature, for which he assigned Ward to direct. Walt was stubborn, Ward says. Once he got something in his head, that was it. I remember one time when he got really mad at me. I was working on the script for Babes in Toyland because if the picture was not put into production soon, the studio would lose the rights to do the story. So while Walt was over in Europe, somebody in the publicity department, to guarantee that the other studios knew Disney was doing the film, put a full-page ad in the trades that read, "Congratulations to Ward Kimball as he starts direction on Disney's Babes in Toyland." Well, Walt had wanted me to direct, but when he got back from Europe and saw the notice, he thought I was pushing myself. So he removed me from the picture. I went in and pointed out that it was the publicity department that had done it, and I even named the names of the guys involved. But Walt was stubborn, and that was it. This was not the only fight that Walt and Ward got into. One time, Walt and I got into a big fight over politics, Ward says. Walt wanted the staff to donate money to the Nixon campaign, and I vehemently refused. Walt didn't like that, and in fact did not call me back to his bedside when he was dying, where he supposedly gave directions to his underlings about how he wanted things to go after his death. I was in Paris and was getting ready to leave the next morning when I got a phone call telling me Walt was dead. Even though I expected it would happen, I was so stunned that I lay awake in my bed, stiff as a board with my mind racing about what would happen at the Disney Studios. Although he constantly tried to experiment for the rest of his career, more and more Kimball didn't feel welcomed in the creative environment at the studio. And the management did more and more to try to control him. This led to him taking an extended vacation in 1972 and officially retiring on August 31st, 1973. However, over the years, the retired Ward in the studio grew closer again, and he was always very encouraging to the young animators at the studio. Just like the kind of grandfatherly figure the studio needed. He also worked in retirement on a lot of personal artwork.
After working with animation and movement and all the intricate forms of movement, I decided that doing static paintings left a lot to be desired. So I started doing what I call constructions or kinetics. And one of the first ones I did was this thing I call the trolley car. Now this one, you start the action going by giving it a shake, and then you get the movement of the people in the window. I think my next construction was one I call watermelon. And here we come to a door that says closed door went through, and people opened the door and saw the beetle. They immediately realized that what appeared to be watermelon seeds were actually June bugs. This is a large 7-foot painting I did of a I called it Sick Cadillac. This was actually based on an experience I had when I saw a brand new pink Cadillac going down Melrose Avenue, still had its paper license plate, but had been in a terrible wreck. The whole rear end was chewed up. So I decided to paint it like human flesh. And the original car was still able to make a left turn with the indicators. Here's a portrait I painted of my son-in-law. It's a four-sided cube. It keeps turning so you can stop it or enjoy all four views, unlike a static one-view-only portrait. Another thing I discovered down here in the Kimmel Catacombs the other day was some old paintings I had done in the 30s and 40s. The first one it shows Betty, my wife, when she was pregnant. I thought it was so interesting, I made a complete painting of all different views from the sketches I had made. Now, I have one more to show you here. My greatest achievement. I did this when I had the mumps. If you never had the mumps when you were in your 40s, you haven't really had it. I was sick, 106 degrees temperature, but I got out my paints and about 15 minutes, I scumbled in exactly what I saw in the mirror.
He was also well known for his very creative Christmas cards. Ward passed away on July 8, 2002, at the age of 88 in Los Angeles, California. Ward is probably one of our favorite Disney animators. His rebellious nature, coupled with his unique and modern art style, makes him stand out among the other more traditional animators. Style-wise, Ward Kimball was a caricaturist and had a brilliant, endless imagination. He always tried to find the most entertaining way to do a scene and searched till he found the perfect layout. Kimball valued innovation and encouraged people to really try different things. He never repeated himself, and once he felt he mastered something, he always went on to break a new boundary rather than to try and live up to his past best work. He also proved that broad satirical animation can be sincere, meaningful, and precise. This opened up a whole new door for possible Disney characters and really changed the way things were done. Who could possibly imagine where animation would have been without Ward Kimball? We certainly can't. And quite frankly, it's scary to try.
Thank you to these people for your generous support. And a special thank you to John David. You guys are really helping keep this channel afloat. Thank you. Thank you for watching this episode of Dizographies. Don't forget to check out our Patreon and Discord, and click the thumbs up button below if you liked the video. And if you want to be notified when the next episode comes out, subscribe and click the bell. Comment below with characters you would like to see us cover. Further reading and references are linked below. We hope to see you in another Dizography.